Welcome everyone, thanks for attending this talk. This is Fabien Parent, and I'm Neil Armstrong, and we are both employees of BayLibre, embedded software engineering firm. We do custom firmware, SOC support, product development. And we're talking about our war story when we tried using Zephyr to develop a wearable device. Okay.
So what are we talking about? So first we will talk about the history of our project, why we needed RTOS. So there is a lot of RTOS out there. So we will talk about why we choose Zephyr against other options. Then we will introduce quickly Zephyr for people that don't know it. And So all of the work that we did, we intended to port it and upstream it. So for Zephyr, we added a new platform support. And since Neil and I are two Linux engineers, we will make a few comparisons to Linux because we have a Linux background. And finally, we conclude the talk. So the story of this talk is that one company came to us to ask us to write a firmware for their wearable device. We cannot tell too much about this product because it's not shipping yet, but basically it's, so this is a wearable that will ship this year, so we can give the name of the product when it will ship. So I don't know, maybe it will be the first product shipping with Zephyr. I know that there is some other project called Neopanda that monitors the vital sign of babies that are ill. So I don't think it's shipping yet, so maybe we will be the first, I think. So
globally, the architecture of the hardware on which the firmware will be running is a wearable device composed of ARM SoC, okay, connected to STM32L4 and between the SPI bus. And these devices are hot pluggable and are running on Cortex M0 or M something connected to the I2C bus. So our needs was for this part, the main part on the STM32L4. The big MCU was UART to debug, I2C master to drive all the hot pluggable devices, and a great SPI slave because the big SoC was the SPI master. And to have a portable and clean code, we need some basic OS features like a good scheduler, timers, threads, logs, etc. So we need to select the RTOS. Oh, there are many free open source RTOS. We needed permissive license because the code will need permissive license. We need something free as in beer. So the reduced candidate was Nutix. It's a well-known RTOS. We evaluated Zephyr. And we eventually spoke about designing our own OS. So the first option was our own OS. So the pros are it's fun to implement. It's a good time to reinvent the wheel and we do everything the other OS do, but in our ways. We'll be shaped for our needs, our development process. And we understand the entire code base. But the drawback is it takes time, there's no community, hard to maintain, and we will have some bugs. We hard to fix bugs.
So the second option was Nutix. So why did you consider Nutix is that for the last 2 years, I was working on Project Ara, which used Nutix. So we made the bad decision of using that OS. So the pro of Nutix is that we were familiar with it. That's a good point. But also another good point was that it already supported our SoC. The other, so if we had written our own OS, we have to write our own port. And the other OS we considered did not add this SoC support. So the cons, the big cons is the build system is unreliable. So when we use for Aura, basically every time you change configuration, you have to do a make disk clean because you cannot be sure that what you will flash will work. So just to explain why it doesn't work is that Nutix, so when you build it makes .o, then in their process they make .a files with all the .o that they found. So if you have some old .o file, it will be included into the .a file, and when you will link at the end, the link will try to find the first symbol that it can find. So sometimes it will take a symbol that has nothing to do with what you want to compile. So this is completely broken, and we had a lot of headache when our firmware was not working because we didn't make this clean before doing another make. So another point that is really scary is that it's supposed to be a three closed BSD license, but inside the repository you can find a lot of code with other licenses like GPL or so when you want to make a product that will not be that will be proprietary, having GPL code inside is scary. Even if you try to disable it in the configuration, there's still the chance that you can include some GPL code, so that's really scary. Also, Nutix doesn't have a real community. It's mainly one guy that wrote everything. So he wrote like 20,000 commits, and the second person has just 100 commits. And so this is not a real community, and basically we don't trust a project with no community to make a real project like the ones that we are making. So here is a few examples of commits from Nutix. So you can see that there is absolutely no review for the code made by the main author. So he commits things that doesn't compile. He forget to add files, and this is just a few examples.
So the third option was Zephyr. So at the time we evaluated the project, Zephyr was announced like a few weeks before, and the pros were really good because it was in a similar way, really close to Linux in the coding style. All the build system was really close. They kept the kconfig and kbuild as is. They kept the get maintainers, get check patch synchronized with Linux. They wanted, they still want a strong community. It's a goal for them. And they have, they have the same maintaining concept with subsystems and they want a great documentation. They want everything to be documented. So this is a great point. And the bad point, well, at the time, they didn't have the STM32L4 support, only the F1, which is a kind of different older SoC. And it was still young, and it's still young now. And we were quite unsure of the maturity of the project. And there's still no real product using Zephyr in the current form. We know the scheduling and the OS code is comes from Windweaver and it's used in products, but the current form, no, nobody uses really for product, only development purposes. So the obvious winner was Zephyr at this time, because before the Zephyr came in the round, it was not simple as that. But in the meantime, we had knowledge of Minute, but we started the project and schedule was too tight to consider switching into it. But it's a really good alternative, and we won't forget it for next project. So, Zephyr in a nutshell, the future are what new project wants, integrated new lib integration, designed for low memory usage, for very small SoCs to very big chips like x86. Everything highly configurable, it's modular and documented, and you have a modern cooperative and printable threading at no cost. You don't need to buy RTOS to have this. And they want security certification at one point, which is a good point for the future. So
let's see the life cycle. So for the Zephyr 1.6, it's not the last release, but 1.7 was released a few days ago, I think. But I didn't want to remake my slides, so I'm talking about 1.6. So the release cycle was 3-4 months. The merge window was 11 weeks, and the stabilization was 3 weeks. So to put it in comparison to Linux, where the release cycle is 2 or 3 months, merge window is 2 weeks, and stabilization is 8 weeks. So it's two different things. On one side, there is a merge window really long and stabilization quite short. And on the other side, there is a merge window quite short and stabilization that is quite long. So the Linux side is optimized for a really large project with a large number of contributions, while Zephyr is still for, let's say, a smaller project. So right now it fits, but if Zephyr becomes bigger, I think it should maybe move to the way of Linux. So the leadership of Zephyr is basically a TSC, a technical steering community. Basically, to get into the TSC, there is a paid membership level with different rights. So there is Intel, NXP, and others. So this TSC can choose the direction to which the project will go. And basically, every time there is a meeting, they send some meeting minutes on Google Drive. But right now, most of the meeting minutes require permission to access them. By chance, I tried it. If you ask for to access this document, they share it with you, but maybe it can take 2 weeks to get them. So if there is some people from TSC here, please don't require permission to access these documents. So also the maintainers, they don't need to come from the TSC members, which is good. Anyone that writes code can be eligible to become a maintainer. So everything for the decision is spread across Jira, Gerrit, and mailing lists. And also, one of the, I mean, the issue maybe it has been fixed, so I don't know. So I learned at last ELCE that basically on the website, the Zephyr website, the blog posts are controlled through a separate community, which make it kind of hard to post blog post for Zephyr. So I don't know if it has been fixed. Maybe someone can know? No, okay. So the development process for Zephyr is top-down development. So in like Linux, where you have a merge window and people try to put what they want inside this merge window, and if they don't put it, the feature is not included inside the release. So for Zephyr, it's completely different. They are defining a set of features that will be included inside the next release. And basically, if there is some features that run late, it can potentially delay the next release of Zephyr. So one question that I'm asking myself, and I don't think I found any answer on the website or whatever, is that what's the priority for contribution? Because there can be some contribution that are high priorities, like the ones that are supposed to be in the next release. And if I wrote myself some code that is not a high priority function, I try to upstream it, what will be merged first? If I send my contribution first, will it be merged before or after the high priority contribution? So in my opinion, I think they should clarify the priority of contribution between the features that are planned for the next release and the other contribution from maintainers.
So our primary work was to add the support, the SoC support to Zephyr. So at this time, the only STM32 SoC that was supported was the F1. So the simple solution, like everyone does, you simply copy-paste the files and re-implement the difference. So hopefully, the two SoCs were really close, so it was quite simple. And the porting was really fast. We did the basic port in 1.5 days, and the complete tested port in less than one week. And because the OS was well architectured and really simple to use, like Linux actually. So, and most time was spent on debugging on a stupid register issue we didn't add in the code, like every project. So the ISOSC and SPI was really critical to the project we were developing.
So as soon as we have the code, we need to upstream it. So first step, read the F manual. So the documentation is pretty good. So when you read that, basically you know everything that you have to do. So you know the coding standard. So first you clean up your patch to follow the coding standard. You run check patch. Then you upload your patch to Gerrit. And then you wait for reviews. And if there is no reviews, just ping the maintainer on IRC. This is the most important point.
Yeah, and you need to find your login and password.
Oh yeah,
to get it.
I changed at least 3 times my password because I could not log in. So one advice: upstream ASAP because Zephyr is still young, and basically the API is changing super fast. So basically, we made the bad choice of writing the code and then wait for 1 month before starting to upstream it. And when we did the first rebase, nothing was working, everything was broken. So as soon as you have some code that is clean, try to upstream it. For example, the power management code, I had to rewrite it at least 3 times. In the 1.6, they added a unified kernel, basically, and it broke everything in my code. So one advice, merge everything. Otherwise, you will have to rebase and everything will be broken and you will spend hours.
So we will talk about the committee difference between Linux. First of all, a great difference was when we pushed our STM32L4 initial support. Was fully rewritten in native code. We didn't use any external include or anything. And one of the first comments we had on our push was someone from a big company saying, "Oh, please stop your work because we want to push our own HAL to Zephyr, and after." You will rebase on our port and you will reduce the work. So you have the link and you can go and see it. So this is a comparison between with Linux. This is a fresh reply from the DRM maintainer about the Linux position. The position is clear. In Linux, upstream Linux, no HL. Only native code, only maintainable code.
So there was some topic on the mailing list about should we use HL, should we not? Are we going to use HL at the beginning and move to native code? Are we going to native code to HL? So there was an input request rate from the maintainers. At the end of the topic, there was no real reply given on the way to go. And the result of that is that basically there is some vendor HL that are slowly replacing native drivers. I mean, at least for ST. So also another point is that right now, most of the maintainers are from SOC companies. So basically, on Linux, they prefer to not have any vendor maintainers for the top level maintainers. So why they do that is that because top level maintainers that are not from vendor are not pressured to include something, so they can say no, I don't want this code, I don't want this HL or whatever. So personally, I prefer to not have HL, so I would love to have a definite answer from the maintainer about that, of how the way to go. So now we will review the tools used by Zephyr. So we have Gerrit for a review of patches and patch series. So we have Jira for the feature and enhancement request. So this replaces the RFC documentation list submission on LKLM and mailing list for development discussion, a question, or whatever. And I didn't include another one, but there is a IRC. So I included a link about a great talk from GateKH that explain the tools that they are using for Linux, why they are not using that tool, or why they are using another tool. So this is really great talk, so I advise everyone to go watch it. So in my opinion, there is too much review tools, because the discussion are spread over Gerrit or Jira or mailing list, and basically it's hard to follow. You don't know where to look. So Jira, the pros are manager friendly. It's easy to do graph, stats, cons. I find it quite developer unfriendly. It takes a lot of time to use that tools compared to mailing list, or you just write an email and that's it. So as I said before, it's yet another communication tool that is overlapping with mailing list and Gerrit. And there is no real information on the wiki on how to use it. If we should use it, if we should open ticket all the time, only for and if it's only for the big features that will land in the next release, or if a community contributor should open tickets. So, I mean, the usage is quite ambiguous for me. So maybe it's something that should be addressed. Gerrit, I hate that software. So the pro, it's easy to not forget patches. The cons, it's super slow, really slow. It's way more complicated than patches. You can have issues all the time when pushing that you don't understand, with a weird error message while email just work. So one of the biggest defects of Gerrit, in my opinion, is that you have to select the reviewers. So at least Grid is you can modify it. So what they did for Zephyr is that they try to look at the maintainer of a file that you modified and add it automatically. But the fact that you have to add reviewers, it means that basically the people that really review your patch are only the maintainers. For open source project, my opinion is that you should have as much eyeball on your patch as possible, because it can only make the code better and have more review. So another subject is that there is no real concept of patch theories when you push. The closest is to add topics to your patch theories, and it makes the sending patch more complicated, because if you send a V2 that is quite different for your V1, you will have to do a lot of manual work in Gary to draw up some patch or whatever. Another issue is that archive is really bad. And one of the issues that I also have is that you cannot watch a patch at once. You can only see the modification on one file at a time. It's really useful to get a full view of a patch to review. Another issue for me is that basically it's a tool that is very visual. So when you log to Gerrit, the first thing you will see is that you have some incoming patch review to do. And you have some, on the right, you have a minus one to say that the patch was already reviewed by someone and it was hacked. You have a plus one that the patch was reviewed by someone and it was hacked. And you get plus two when the maintainer accepts the patch. So this visual representation of whether your patch is reviewed or not, for me, it's really bothering, because when someone puts a minus one, basically you can be sure that no one else will review your patch. Even if the minus one was for a not good reason. So I think it's slower the patch reviews to that kind of visual feedback. If you compare to email, basically you have no choice than read the first email, then read the response. So it's more linear, and I prefer it. So once again, I advise you to go to see the talk from Greg Cage that I linked in the previous slide. Finally, mailing list. It works. So also, if you use mailing list for everything, everything is in the same place, so it's easy to find what you want. You just search and you get it. Like Jira, where you have to find in Jira, or maybe it's not in Jira, then you will find maybe your question answer in Gerrit, or maybe no, it's in the mailing list. So if it's everything in the mailing list, it's easy and it works. Cons, I didn't find any. So let's conclude. So for us, the pros for Zephyr was it was really similar to Linux. We're coming from a Linux background, so basically it was super easy to move to Zephyr. The API are simple and well documented. I mean, it's one of the first projects where basically when I want to use something, basically in most projects, I just look at the include, look at the prototype of function and try to understand. But with the documentation is really great, so basically you just look at the documentation and basically you can understand the most part of the system. The community of Zephyr exists, and it's real and active, which is really great. So if you go to the Gerrit, you will see a lot of patch sent every day. So I think the design is good for low memory usage on small CPU compared to other RTOS like Nautix, where it's using heap everywhere and it's using more memory than Zephyr. The flaws are really getting fixed quickly. So maybe 6 months ago, the slides would be two times bigger with 10 slides of flaws that basically we had to remove because they all get fixed. So for example, it's an anecdote, but when I first pushed patches to Gerrit, basically there is a bot that tries to validate and build your patches, and basically you get before any review you get 3 emails from Gerrit per patches. So when I sent a series of 10 patches, I got 30 emails in the 2 hours following my submission in my mailbox, which was quite annoying. Also, one other issue is that on Gerrit there was some false build failure report from Jenkins, so it got fixed also, so that's a good thing. And one of the issues that I had with Zephyr was, for example, for drivers, there was half the driver was a static configuration, but right now there is a undergrowth that is working on device 3 that should remove all this code to another file, and basically I think it will make Zephyr really great when it will be implemented. So there was a talk about that this morning, so if you didn't see it, I advise you to go see the video when it will be posted online. So that's all for the pros, now the cons.
So for conclusion of our triad, we really want a real plan for the HLs, a real something which is within everywhere, the maintainers, the TSC are real position for the maintainability in the time. So this is one point. The tools for the review was really mega sad because we spent like nearly 1 month to get our 10 really simple patches merge, because it was really only a copy of the existing F1 support. We didn't add new frameworks, no new config. We only copied one SoC to another in the same structure, same way, identical. And we sent like 6 versions of the patch set, which is something I think won't happen in Linux when the code is well written and based on something which is already working and accepted. And the review was really discouraging because there was very few returns from the maintainers. The patches was reviewed by some random guys we don't know, with contradictory reviews. We don't know which comment we need to implement. The maintainer never said, okay, now ignore this one, take this one, like we have in the Linux community. When you send a patch set, at the end, the maintainer says, okay, ignore this, do this. And we didn't add this at any time. So it was really discouraging for us. But it's evolving, so I think it will go in the right way. And the code is still very young, and APIs are changing very, very fast, so we need to really look and test the code every release to see if it's still working. But this morning in the previous talk, there is a rumor of eventually switching to GitHub for instead of Gerrit, so maybe it will solve some problems. It's not perfect, but it will be better than Gerrit, for sure. So it's okay for me. If you have some questions, feel free to ask them.
No question? Okay, thank you.